Please read her whole bio on our website, and please help me welcome Vanessa to the Creative Morning stage.
Y'all, thank you. This means so much. How are you? Y'all look beautiful. Y'all look blessed. Good morning. So, like Kira said, my name is Vanessa Giffrard. I'm a life-affirming sex educator here in Baltimore, and I'm super excited to be with you all today. And so, shout out to Creative Mornings for inviting me here, and thank you so much for spending the morning. So, when I got the call that I was going to talk about touch, of course, I was like, ooh, yes, they hit me up. They hit me up end of January, and so when I heard touch, I was like, oh, these people know me. We're about to be talking about touching some of these, right? Like, I could do this. Like, I can teach y'all how to do this. This is light work. And I was like, oh, yeah, that's what I'm about to do. I'm about to come in. I'm going to teach y'all how to touch vulvas and vaginas, and we're going to call it a morning, right? And that's another creative morning. Kira, you heard that? I'll be back. And so when I thought about the actual theme and when I thought about what touch means, when I think about the definition of touch and when I think about how touch has impacted my life, I have to dig deeper and I have to think about connection. That's what touch means to me. It's about connection. And so when I think about my connection to my work as a sex educator, I have to think about how I, in order to do this work passionately, in order to do this work exuberantly, in order to show up as myself in this work, I had to get in touch with myself. I had to get in touch with my passions. I had to get in touch with the things that have shamed me, that have been taught to me. I've had to get in touch with my pleasure and get in touch with the joys that I have in order to be able to connect with others. Are y'all riding this train with me? I'm saying touch. Okay. So in order to really delve deep and for y'all to understand my definition of touch, it starts with my story. And so walk with me here. We're together. We're on the journey. Are y'all here? Let's do it. So I am, like Kira said, I am the child of Haitian immigrants. And I actually took this photo, those two immigrants right there. Those are my parents. You can't see them. and if you know anything about being an immigrant kid, are there any immigrant kids in here? Yeah. Right. Okay. We'll do the support group later. You know that there aren't a lot of conversations about sex. You know there aren't a lot of conversations, depending on who your parents are. There's not a lot of touching and I love yous going on. But we have a lot of great values that come along with that as well. And then another thing that's core to my identity is I was raised Catholic. I identify as being Catholic, and I went to Catholic school from third grade to 12th grade, and that was an interesting experience. Walk with me. So when I think about sex ed, did anybody get formalized sex ed in school?
Yeah.
We'll have that talk later as well. But so for the people that kind of got it and for the people that didn't, I'll walk you through my journey. And so third grade, you know, we don't really talk about things like that. Fifth grade, we got a talk, we got a book, and in the book we were only, in this entire book, we had a story about Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve weren't allowed to touch each other. They weren't allowed to do anything. They were just supposed to follow God. The end. Good night. That was the only talk that we got, right? Nothing about periods, puberty, nothing. Then I get to high school. And in high school, I meet Miss Sora. And Miss Sora is very adamant about telling us that you're not allowed to touch your partner, even though you're married, unless you want to have babies. And I was like, Miss Sora, hold up, Miss Sora. Give me a second. Okay, so we're supposed to wait. We're not supposed to do it. We get married, right? And you tell me I'm still not supposed to do it? So I was confused, right? Like, I said, Miss Sora, like, I don't know if this is the life for me, sis. Like, this is weird. Like, I don't, okay. Miss Sora was like, you just gotta pray the feelings away. So I was like, all right, Miss Sora, cool. So then I get to 12th grade, and in 12th grade, we had morality class. And morality class is, I like to think of it as the class that they make you have before you go to college, where you don't bust it wide open in college. So we had a nurse come in, and this nurse says, hey, couples that have sex before marriage will break up within 4 to 5 years. Couples that use condoms, they will get pregnant because condoms don't work, and they'll break up within 4 to 5 years. Everything bad that's going to happen if you have sex before marriage will happen within 4 to 5 years. So I'm like, I'm a scholar, y'all, so I'm in the front row. So I was writing down, I was taking notes. So the next year, I head to University of Maryland, and I meet this friend of mine, and I remember this friend. We were walking across the quad, and I tell him, I don't know how this, I tried to think about how this conversation happened. I told him, I said, listen, when I have sex, I'm never using condoms. Listen, when I have sex, I don't want to break it with my boo within 4 to 5 years. So, you know, I'm just going to just like go for it, okay? And so he essentially looked at me and he was like, who hurt you? Where the hell, like, where did you learn, like, what? And he was like, have you ever heard of, I don't know, STDs? Have you ever heard of, like, pregnancy disease? Like, what's going on with you, right? And I was like, no, absolutely not. I had no clue of what he was talking about. And that's when I realized in that moment that I was clueless. And in that moment, I knew and I felt like something was taken from me. I knew and felt like I didn't have a choice in the matter, right? And so as soon as he started talking about how pregnancy happens and how people get HIV and how people get STIs and all these things, y'all, I was clueless. I realized I had no idea what was going on, what life was, what even healthy relationships were, what power looked like, what consent looked like, all of these things that someone should have talked to me about and conversations we should have had at school, conversations we should have had at home. And so essentially, I felt robbed. So I made it my business. I said, wait a second. I said, people have sex and babies cut, like what? And here's the thing, side note. I thought the way that people did it was the way that you do it on soap operas, like you just like, you have to have rose petals, you have to have candles, and you just like, ooh. Like, I thought that was it, you just lay there. So I didn't know what was going on. And so that year, I started joining every single type of campus group you could think of to get informed, to lobby. I lobbied around sex ed. I did all this work to educate my fellow peers because I knew that if this was my experience, how many other people had this experience, right? How many other people were growing up in households where we didn't have these conversations, where we didn't talk about the good touch, right? Or the bad touch, or the touch that can essentially, you know, alter the course of your lives. How many people didn't have the talks about healthy relationships? How many people weren't connected to their bodies? And so I decided to organize all around University of Maryland. Go Terps, where y'all at? Okay. I see y'all don't give to the alumni. Okay, anyway. And so this is a photo of me and one of like the activations that I did around Mardi Gras where I threw beads of condoms on people. I went to bars, was handing out cupcakes and condoms. And I just wanted people to be engaged with themselves and engage in this work around themselves so that they can lead healthier and more empowered lives. And then graduated from college, started my career, and like I said, what became super important to me was making sure that we had a new generation of folks that would feel empowered and would understand themselves a little bit more. And so that's the work that I do every day, and I absolutely love it. It gives me so much life. And in doing this work with children and young people, I realized, hold up. A lot of us were children who still didn't get the tools that we needed, right? So I'm working with adults at this point, and there's a lot of myths that I'm noticing with adults. And what I started noticing was they were women and femmes, folks with vulvas and vaginas, or people who have been socialized as women, who did not understand their bodies, didn't have a safe place to connect with other folks to share stories. And so what I did was literally open my home. And when I say open my home, I mean literally open my home. My husband is like, hey, so listen, y'all, love that y'all are talking about coochies here, but it's time to go home. So I opened up my home, and what I started noticing in the field and when I started educating was that, you know, I was working with women in their 20s, in their 30s, even in their 60s, who've had sexual experiences that weren't empowering, or they were having experiences and didn't understand, or having children and didn't understand where those children were coming out of, like even basic anatomy. And I realized there was a problem here that needed to be solved. And I also realized that, you know, women and femmes needed areas and places to feel connected to one another, to share our stories. I feel like storytelling is a very powerful tool. And I also feel that when people see themselves and are able to speak about their experiences openly, we're able to eliminate that shame. We're able to work through that stuff and make sure that we're more empowered. And so that's where vagisteam came from. And so vagisteam, like Kira said, is a term that I coined. And it was the workshop series and podcast that I started to create a connection point so that women and femmes could feel empowered. You know, the people with penises, y'all could join too. Ain't nothing wrong with that. But it was essentially a place for that, for us to share our stories and for us to connect to ourselves and connect to our sexuality. And so, coochies is what I essentially have the honor and the pleasure of doing every single day. I get to connect people around their joys. I get to connect people around their pleasure. I get to connect people around learning about their pleasure and learning how to eliminate the stuff that they don't need. I get to help people tap into their bad bitchesness and walk freely in their sexuality. And that is, you know, that is what touch means to me. This is where I feel the most connected. This is where I feel the most free. And my only hope is that other people feel that way as well. And so this is where we land, right? And when I think about the culmination of experiences, when I think about the connection to my work, I see this as tapping deeper into myself and essentially being a tool where other people feel empowered to dig deeper into themselves as well. And so what I will leave you with today is I want us to think about how do we get in touch with our pleasures? How do we do that? This is a call and response. Y'all get an answer. How can we start today to get in touch with our pleasure? And it doesn't need to just be sexual pleasure. I know some of y'all are still working on it. I saw the body language. How can we get in touch with our pleasure starting today? Ooh, release that anti-fun spirit. Yes. What else? Thank you. You got to identify first. What is pleasure for you? Yes. What else can we do starting today? You said? Letting go of shame. I heard something else. Ooh. 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 I'll be writing in my journal tonight. How can we, my second ask of you in starting today, how can we get more in touch with our joy? How can we do that? Listen, Beyonce's not giving out PPE loans, so we can't. She said, quit your job, and we were like, yeah, wait. You will break my soul job, but I still got to clock in. So we got quitting our job is an option for some. What else can we do to get in touch with our joy starting today? Yes. Yes. What it does it mean to you? Yes. Perfect. What else? Yes.
Prioritize it. So make time for it, like make it an appointment.
Ooh.
Whatever the case may be, so it's not pushed to the side.
Yes, prioritize it. Yes. Anybody else? These are great, y'all. Come up on the stage so we can do this here. Anyway. Anything else? Ooh, be a joy to others. I love that. How do we get in touch with our passions? What can we start doing today to get in touch with our passions? Ooh, try new things. I like it. I challenge you to do that. What else? What else can we do? Ooh, yes. Be intentional and make time for it. And so that's the message, y'all. Like, that's what I want to leave you with. I want you, I know it's easier said than done, but we all can take 5 minutes, right? And when we're intentional about it, when we're intentional about our pleasure, when we're intentional about tapping into our joy, when we are intentional about rooting out the stuff that we don't need, we can start being on our path to liberation, right? We can start being on our path to our best selves and our most happy selves, our most joyful selves. And so start that today. All of these great suggestions, I want you to incorporate them. And I want you to start thinking about how 5 minutes a day, think about the scents, think about the clothes, think about the small things. Like, for me, it's like opening up the window and being able to let the sun in. That's that 5 minute thing that I do every morning to be like, okay, we out here, and that's a little bit of joy, a little bit of pleasure that we can bring into our lives. So y'all, thank you so much. I had a great time with y'all. I hope you learned something. And yeah, that's it.
We're gonna ask you questions next. So you just hold on to that, you know. Thanks, Vanessa.
Thank you so much for having me.
We are in the question and answer period now. So if people have some questions, you can go ahead and raise your hand. But I can start.
Yeah.
So what's next for Vagisteam? What do you got going on?
Well, Kara did not come prepared with an answer for that. But coming up tomorrow, I'll be at the Black Ass Flea Market at the Reginald Lewis Museum. And so, you know, Vagisteam has merch, as you all saw. Hint, hint. Anyway. we'll be doing education at the table. There'll be merch. There'll just be good happiness vibes overall. But yeah, Vagisteam has had to take a little break because part of my pleasure and joy routine is to take breaks and sleep and nap. I had a baby, and so I had to slow it down. Thank you. That is the fruit of my loins. Thank you for cheering for what my womb can do. I'm expecting to, you know, slowly creeping back on. And so you can see what Vagisteam is doing on Instagram. That's where I'm most likely talking my shit. So you can follow me at Vagisteam and see what's going on. But I'm hoping to bring events back out, creep back into my podcast, and yeah, bring folks together again.
Yeah, that sounds great.
Yeah.
Do we have questions? Oh, here we go.
Hi, thank you. This is so, like, empowering, warming this morning.
Thank you.
So my question is, I feel like a lot of times when people are raised in a Christian or like semi-conservative religious environment, mm-hmm. there's a assumption that they'll sort of take those values into the rest of their life. And what I mean by that is, like, you know, there's like a lot of talk about evangelical Christians and how they have these values, and if they have those values when they're like younger, they'll just always carry them forward, and that creates a lot of division in our society.
Yeah.
But I have a similar story to yours, where I was also raised in a conservative immigrant childhood household and mm-hmm. also went to college and was like, my eyes were open. So one thing I'm always curious about is, why did you feel like you were so receptive after all those years of being told one thing to Ooh. Going to college and being opened up in that way?
Ooh, that's a good question. Okay. Wow. All right. Okay, Oprah. You know, so... I think it took me a while. So I'm not going to say that I got to college and then I heard with my friend, now husband, that's my boo right there. So I wasn't, like, he was telling me stuff and we had very different views on things. And it wasn't always easy to process. But I put myself in spaces and groups where people didn't always, like, look like me or sound like me or believe the same things that I did. And there was a group in college called Community Roots, and they just did teach-ins on just literally every single topic you can think of, from female genital mutilation to mining cell phone parts to the signs of happiness, just, like, stuff like that where they have speakers come in and talk and just being around others, which I think is the value in being in spaces like this where we're mixing, we're mingling, we're spending time with people, we're actually learning and talking to one another, is super important because those gems start getting dropped. And if you're open and receptive enough to it, you'll learn something, right? And so not every worldview has to be my worldview, but I can integrate, I can see where other people are coming from, I can do my own research. And so your question makes me think of the post that I have on my Facebook circa 2005 was a different person, 2005, 2006, and I'm going to tell y'all right now that they're bad, so when I become famous, don't you dare try and pull them out, because I'm claiming it right now, they were trash. Don't be during my Oscar Emmy night trying to pull up tweets and stuff. I'm already telling you, I'm claiming it. So those, when I look at those posts where I'm like, oh, why do all these females gotta be wearing short shorts and stuff? Like, don't they respect themselves? And, oh, why are you wearing makeup? Men don't like makeup. Woo! Shout out to growth, right? And so I think growth, education, and grace, and the grace that other people gave me and willing to pour into me and have these dialogues with me definitely opened up my worldview and opened me up so that I can change and evolve. And I feel like I'm still changing and evolving. There's still stuff that I don't even know where I may fall on certain things, but having the openness to be able to learn and venture out and have grace and growth for myself is, I feel like, has been key in doing that work. So That's what I would say. We don't have to stick to the thing that we learned just because it was the thing that we learned that we're familiar with. Thank you for that question.
Kier.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning.
I wanted to ask a question about your work with the youth.
Yeah.
What is your approach on introducing pleasure as well as maybe sexual education or those kind of topics with are chronologically younger people?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So a lot of my work that I do with young people is in Baltimore City schools and also in youth groups around Baltimore City. And so essentially I do get to come in after somebody has invited me in, which is great, or I work with schools to, you know, what I do with schools essentially is letting them know how important this topic is, because there's still a lot of buy-in. Sex education is not mandated in this country. It's not mandated in the sense that every single child at every single school is getting the same type of sex education, the same type of puberty education at every single school in this, even in this little city, more or less the state. And so there's a lot of work that goes into talking to the stakeholders, which are teachers, counselors, principals, and letting them know, like, hey, you have this population at your school. You know, at this age, we want to start, you know, talking to them about their bodies and really giving, like, letting them be the partner in having these conversations. And what I mean by being the partner, because they are the adult gatekeepers, sometimes they're like, I'm not ready to talk about that. So I'll be like, okay, well, tell me what you're ready to talk about, and let's start there. You know, everybody needs healthy relationships. Can we start a healthy relationships? All right, let's start there. Like, everybody needs to know about, you know, bodily autonomy. Can we start there? And so I try and work my way in that way. My philosophy, however, on sex education, I think that as soon as a person hops out, comes into the world, they need to start getting that education. And I think that the thing that scares people is the sex part. And I have to remind parents, who I educate as well, I have to remind caregivers that I'm not coming into the classroom talking about laying the rose petals on the, you know, on the floor and on the bed. We're talking about starting off with conversations such as like, hey, are we sharing our toys? That's a skill. That's a skill that will then evolve into something later. When our kids are starting to get older, are they able to start naming the parts of their body correctly and not using nicknames for those parts? And as a way to empower them to speak up if anybody is violating their boundaries. They're learning about good touch, bad touch, confusing touch, and weird people. And they're also, I like to teach my students about, you know, listening to their intuition and listening to their bodies when something feels off. And then, you know, going up the spectrum, we're talking about STIs, we're talking about birth control, we're talking about porn, we're talking about social media. And so my approach is more so trying to get that buy-in from every level, including the students too. But what I find is that students and young people, they're prepped and ready, like they want to talk about this so badly. Every single time I leave a classroom, there's 20 million hands that shoot up, and I'm like, I'll be back next week. And they're like, no, please, please, please. I have to know how people have twins. And I'm like, okay, calm down. Or my favorite, a sixth grader being like, wait, I'm sorry, you didn't give us magnums. What's going on? And I'm like, young sir, please, don't embarrass yourself. I feel like essentially the barrier to this work at times is really adults. I have not encountered a kid that's been like, I don't need to know anything about it, I don't want to. And if they are like that, it's typically from the attitudes that were essentially taught to them. So things like, well, you know, my mom said I don't have to know this stuff. I'm like, well, why? Don't we all have elbows and knees and bodies and butts and, you know, stuff to learn about and how to take care of our bodies? And so trying to bring people along, I feel, is my approach. And meeting them halfway is my approach to this work. Thank you.
Hey.
My question is, how have you reconciled what you do with your really kind of secluded upbringing with your family? Like, do you talk to them about this?
Yes, I do. So I would have had my parents here this morning. I just didn't know how deep, when I was writing my outline, I didn't know how deep I was going into the sex stuff. And then I was like, Vanessa, wait, you talked in front of your parents about this stuff a million times, because during the pandemic, I was teaching classes online and they were in the area. And my dad's like, huh, female condoms. Get a load of that. But this is a really good question. So for a while, I was keeping my word. Like, I feel like something, an ethos that I learned a while ago from a person that calls themselves the fat sex therapist on Instagram said, I went to a conference presentation of hers, and she was talking about her coming out and how she put a lot of pressure on herself to come out. And she, I think her background, I believe her parents are from India, or their parents are from India, I'm sorry. And they were saying how, you know, when they were trying to come out, they were like, oh, I gotta sit my parents down, I gotta go through this process, I gotta like literally come out and tell them. And when they thought about it, they were like, wait, that's not the way that our people do it. Like, we have a very, you know, adults do adult things, children stay in children's lane, and we don't mix that at all, really. And so when they started, like, tapping deeper into the cultural aspect of it, they were like, wait, this whole, like, I have to sit everybody down, I need to make a proclamation, what they essentially said at the conference was something like, you know, this is very, like, European, this is very Eurocentric, this is very white in how we're trying to, American, this is how we're trying to go about this. And that's not me. I don't have to fit in that box. And so I think for the longest time, my struggle was like, I want my parents to understand what I do. And my parents didn't care as long as I was eating. Like, my mom has never looked at me and was just like, condom demonstrations. Like, well, I never said that. Like, now, you know, my mom, like, at first when I started doing my work, like, and because I've been doing this since college, she's kind of seen it, like, sprinkled around. So she's seen, like, you know, my drawer of, you know, demo condoms. She's seen my drawer of, like, wooden penis models. And she's been like, And, you know, to be honest, like, my mom didn't even feel comfortable having the sex talk with me until my wedding day. Like, on my wedding, like, putting on the veil, putting on necklace. And my mom was like, Vane, I have something that I would like to, you see, you know, as a woman. And I was like, Mommy, we don't have time for this. Like, we gotta go. So Tilda said, you know what? You've inspired me to go ask my mom what she was going to say, because we still haven't had that talk. Because I cut her off, because I was like, sis, like, we're already an hour late. Like, what's up? And so I had a lot of pressure on myself to try and integrate my parents into my work. And, like, you know, I feel like I'm, you know, I'm being, like, walking in secrecy. And, you know, I want them to be proud of me. And the thing is, they were already proud of me. And I feel like the core of immigrant parents is like, is you eaten? Are you a doctor? Are you a lawyer? Are you a nurse? Are you an engineer? And so when I wasn't any of those things, which was a deep disappointment to my mom, you know, I had to bring her along and say, like, this is, you know, this is kind of like my vision. This is what I think I want to do, this, you know, public health thing. I think I want to do this education thing. And it's kind of evolved for myself as well. And so I feel like I opened the door to my mom, more specifically, to join me in this when I, like, invited her to a How to Talk to Your Kids About Sex class that I was doing for parents. And my mom sat right in the front row, and the entire time she was, like, listening, she was taking notes, and when we walked out, she was like, I talked to you about that. I'm like, yeah, no. Come on, girl. Don't do that. And we were able to have an open conversation. When she was like, oh, my God, this is what you do. So she was able to see it because I was able to invite her in, and that was like my cracking the door. And now my mom is all on it. So that picture that we had up, my mom has held. Yes. My mom is like, why is that vagina so smooshy? What are you teaching people? You know? And I think it's helped my parents kind of be like, oh, okay, we don't have to be so uptight about this. And I think as I'm educating them more and they're seeing more of what I'm doing, they're starting to understand the importance of having these conversations. And me and my mom have been able to talk about, like, why she didn't. And she's been able to say, like, I just didn't know. This wasn't something that we were taught when I was growing up. And this is not something that we even discuss now. She's like, there's no way I could tell your grandmother I'm teaching people about vagina stuff. Like, there's no way that that could have happened. But, you know, she's recognized that, like, you know, we're in a different space. We're in a different time. And now that I've had a baby, oh, now my mom is fully open, okay? She's just like, so, what are you and Chris doing? Like, girl! So when's the second, you know, Rihanna had a little baby again. Okay, so stuff like that is able to happen. So I think letting other people into our world slowly in a way that's culturally in tune for us and also at our pace is definitely helpful. So that's how I've been able to bring them along. Yeah.
Y'all, can you help me thank Vanessa?